All right, fellas, at what point in your careers did you guys get the idea that you might have some special talent in this sport, that you were a little bit different than the guys you were playing with?
You go ahead, Karts.
Yeah, for me, I probably didn't know that until college. And when I played college hockey my freshman year, I scored more goals than I probably should have. And it was probably at that moment that NHL scouts started to call me and say, hey, you know, where are you at? What are you thinking? And to me, it was like, whoa, what are you calling me for? I don't know. You sure? And it's funny. I golfed with Dan Plant the other day, and he said he was an agent at the time. He called me, and I don't recall this, but he says, I called you and asked if you have any representation. And I said, no. You got the wrong phone number. You don't want to talk to me.
What is representation?
I don't need an agent. I'm just playing college hockey right now. Yeah, I don't need an agent. That's fine. But thanks for the call. And he went on his way. And then, sure enough, it was probably less than 12 months later that I ended up signing an NHL contract. So it was really in that short time frame, probably from my freshman year of college to the end of that to the end of my sophomore year.
Yeah, I mean, for myself, I was a bit of a, it sounds like you were a late bloomer a little bit. I was a late bloomer myself, too. The first time for me when I really understood maybe that I have a chance was when I had an opportunity to try out for Team Canada in the World Junior Tournament. I was one of the last probably guys to make that team with Eric Lindros and Chizowski and Stefan Fissett, and making that World Junior team was really exciting for me and kind of where it kind of set the bar for me.
For you, you had a chance very earlier in your career to be a part of a team that won a cup. I know that you didn't play a ton for them, but then a few years later you did play a major role on a team that made it back to the finals. What were those two runs to the finals like?
Yeah, I think, you know, having been in the situation I was with Anaheim, where I was kind of a fly on the wall. That was my first year pro. I played the whole season in the minors, and then I got a chance to play some playoff games, and I don't know that I had a huge impact, but I remember my first game because I sat on the bench, and I'm sitting next to Teemu Selanne, who at that point in his career was already going to be in the Hall of Fame. And I could barely hear him talk because my heart was beating so hard. Right? It was beating so hard. I was like, say that again. And he could see I was nervous. He's like, it's okay, dude, calm down. I didn't soak it in the way that I maybe would have had I done it another way. So to get a chance to play a role with New Jersey and a role that helped win games and score goals at one games in big spots, it was fun, and it kind of, for me, validated the first one.
Who was the toughest matchup for you? The toughest when you had, this is the guy against whom I'm playing tonight, I know I'm in for a heck of a battle. Who was the best player you had to check?
Well, there was different types of guys. Like Mike Modano, for me, the way he skated was one of the toughest guys. When Mike was on the ice, I would swing with him with speed, and he would get so frustrated. And then Joe Sakic, for me, in the offensive zone, he was so good at passing the puck here and then jumping past you. He used the players around him and was so smart. So probably those two guys were the most difficult in my career to check.
For me, well, and this is going to sound easy, but Sidney Crosby was really tough for me. He was just a step ahead of me, and it drove me bananas because I'd see a spot where maybe I think I can pinch him off, I can get his hands and pin him. But that's what I learned was that's what he wanted me to think, right? Because he has an out. He knows where he's going from there.
Was there a night where, hey, tonight I got into this guy's kitchen, I got this guy rattled just by being all over him defensively?
I don't know. I would probably have to say probably against Vancouver, Bertuzzi, when Bertuzzi, Morrison, and Naslin played together. Those guys often would bark at each other, those three guys, and a lot, especially during the playoffs when we played those guys, especially Bertuzzi, be banging a stick, and, you know, obviously we'd come back to the bench at the same time, and you'd always hear the door slam on the other side. It's something that would, you never look over there, but you could always hear it, and then I'd always say to my buddy, I go, Laxo, let's keep doing what we're doing. They're slamming doors over there.
For me, I think I'll go back to the 2012 run when we're playing the New York Rangers, collectively, the way the Devils played, it was tough to score against, and you kind of had to take risk. And I don't think there was an individual player that I drove nuts. I think I recall it was the coach, Tortorella. You know, he's losing his mind. They've got nothing against us, and they're trying, and the coach is just on the bench. He's just defeated, and he's losing his mind. He's snapping, he's yelling at every one of them up and down. And he's so mad. You're like, okay, we're doing this right, you know, and just calm down. It's not over. You got to stay on the gas, but, you know, they're frustrated, and what we're doing is actually working. And then at the same time, like, that builds trust in you and your team and your coach, and when the snowball gets going, good things happen.